The third panelist of the day is Dr. Aparna Rayaprol ma'am, here to enlighten us on sociology and its role in the catastrophe. Professor Aparna Rayaprol ma'am secured her PhD in America and belongs to the first generation immigrants who went abroad. After graduating, she continued her teaching career for several years. She later came to India and joined the Tata Institute of Social Sciences in Mumbai as an instructor. As the head of Department of Sociology at the Central University of Hyderabad, she introduced a new study program for foreign students called Study in India, a four-week course not available in any other university in the country. The course has been running successfully for 20 years. Apart from immigration research, under her aegis, a lot of work is being done on gender discrimination and gender socialization. She has also been conducting many workshops and seminars in schools and colleges in this field. We are honored to have you here, ma'am. I now introduce our fourth speaker of the day, Dr. C. Veena ma'am, who is here to elucidate upon psychology. Dr. C. Veena ma'am, formerly a professor of psychology and head department of psychology in Osmania University, is a pioneer and expert in fields of cognitive psychology, personality types, and applied behavior modification. She has been conferred Ashoka Fellowship by Ashoka, an organization that promotes social entrepreneurship. Her work over the years has been in the identification of triggers, responses, patterns of errors, and correction of such patterns through behavior modification. She has helped reform nearly 4,000 criminals in 11 Telangana jails. While working with Telangana Prisons Department on its Unnati program, which is aimed at reforming the prisoners, she was invited by the Kennedy School of Governance in Harvard University for discussion on the subject, reducing recidivism and crime rate through cognitive psychology. It's a pleasure to have you join us, ma'am.
Morning to all of you. Thank you to Dr. Sudharani for inviting me to participate in this very fascinating seminar, interdisciplinary and with distinguished panelists. Now, what does the sociologist have to say during a crisis? One of the big things that I feel is absolutely necessary, especially for technology and engineering students, is to get a context and understand a sociocultural background context of what exactly happens during a crisis. And for this, of course, since yesterday you have been listening to historians, political scientists, and economists who may have provided their particular context. We are a discipline with a wider focus and a wider lens, and we go into understanding the why and how do we prepare ourselves and challenge ourselves for what exactly is happening around us. Now, let me take a very, very small example about the current crisis. So today I am going to spend some time talking about the levels of caregivers that we have in society. And who does our crisis make us look toward? Constantly we are looking at certain kinds of people to provide us with certain kinds of help to combat a crisis. When we look for an ambulance, do we look at the person who's driving the ambulance, whether he is being taken care of, whether his job is secure? Similarly, the number of people who have been protesting outside Gandhi Hospital because they don't have proper wages. I think 70 years after independence, and we give a lot of speeches about how we have come as a nation and our greatness, but have we been able to take care of the carer? So in one sense, I think every institution has a backbone, the service industry. And how do we look at the service industry? Are we really prepared? So in this sense, the nurses, the ayahs and the ward boys in the hospitals, the quarantine workers, these are the people who are, from our perspective, the invisible backbone of the workforce. How does the workforce react to this kind of a situation? When we see online classes, many of our students remind us that if they are sitting in a tribal village in Manipur, accessibility is not the same as those sitting in Gachibowli. So how do we deal with these synchronous classes? We may have to actually record, send. So does the phone become the, vehicle of change? As you know, so how do we actually read? They all rushed home in a hurry. Some of them didn't even take their books. Do they have the bandwidth literally and metaphorically to be able to download and manage these kinds of things? There are many, many questions that remain, but think of an equal world where the young girls and boys are going to be doing things together as children and not in a divisive kind of world. Once again, thank you very much.